Good afternoon, hello, and welcome to the Omni Coalition News Show, aka Talkness. This show is an amalgam of strange, weird, bizarre, off the wall, and otherwise things you don't normally see anymore in the news these days. You know, for the most part, during a time of political overabundance and divisiveness, we present you with more topics, or more unifying topics to discuss. For links to those articles, the music, and anything else potentially interesting, check the underbar in the description below. Anyway, I am Ayo Xander, and you, audience viewer, are you. Today is Freya's Day, aka Friday, March 24th, 2023. So let's jump into the news today, shall we? We have quite a bit of articles for you, actually. I'm going to start us off here from Oddity Central. Man exercises 8 hours a day for 20 years, now he can't walk. Alright, well, you know, maybe exercise is not the answer, so let's see what this says here. A 60-year-old man who used to work out for 8 hours a day, walking, jogging, and doing hundreds of sit-ups, developed severe degenerative arthritis and is barely able to move because of the pain. They say too much of a good thing is usually bad for you, and apparently exercise is no exception. Chinese newspaper Shanxi Daily recently featured the tragic story of a 60-year-old man from Henan who only discovered exercising in his early 40s, only to start overdoing it to such an extent that he pretty much ruined his joints. The Zhengzhou-based man reportedly exercised about 2.5 hours every morning, walking, running, and doing pull-ups, then swam for about 2 hours and then did 800 sit-ups a day, plus hundreds of push-ups, and some badminton to top it all off. Unfortunately, his body eventually gave in and he started experiencing severe pain in his joints. So, yeah, you know, as with all things, everything in moderation. You know, it is good to exercise, it is healthy, but don't, you know, let it be your entire life, you know, unless you know how to counterbalance all of that stress and fatigue you're doing on the body. You know, you got to supplement everything. So, anyway, let's move on up here. More from Oddity Central. Man climbs 4,100-meter mountain in three-piece suit and leather shoes. Okay, just a matter of time before that was going to happen. A popular Japanese tailor and adventurer recently went viral on social media after climbing Mount Kinabalu, the highest mountain in Malaysia, in a three-piece suit and stylish leather, shoes. Not suit. Anyway, one of the last things you would expect to see at the top of the 4,095-meter Mount Kinabalu is a Japanese fellow wearing a pristine three-piece suit, classy leather shoes. Once again, another spelling mistake there, and an office ID tag around his neck and carrying a messenger bag. And yet, that was exactly the unusual sight that mountaineers at the top of Malaysia's highest peak were treated to this week, as Nobuta Sada, a Japanese tailor and adventurer, posed for photos and videos to post on his popular social media accounts. Sada owns his own bespoke suit label, and he often pulls this kind of stunt to promote his brand. So, let's take a moment to sink in, you know, that he's over 4,000 meters above sea level in a three-piece suit and leather shoes. That's, you know, that's wild. And he has, you know, like he's going to work. So, yeah, moving on up. More from Oddity Central. Talented soap maker's creations look good enough to eat. But, you know what? Maybe this is the ultimate dream of every old-fashioned mother who used to clean their children's mouth out with soap whenever they swore. You know, now it actually looks tasty. Like, oh, here, eat this. You know, that'd be an interesting thing. Anyway, Julia Popova, a talented soap maker based in St. Petersburg, Russia, creates amazingly detailed bars of soap that look like delectable desserts, liquor bottles, or juicy fruits. 9 years ago, when Julia started making her beautiful soap bars, she only made them as gifts for family and friends, but she received such positive feedback that she actually started showing them off on social media. And soon, orders started coming in and the Omnon soap brand was born. Pardon me. In the beginning, she would regularly buy soap bars, melt them, and then mold them into the desired shapes, but soon, as she became more involved in the artistic process, she started buying the base ingredients and then making her own soap. Well, calling it soap doesn't do it justice, as every one of her creations is more like a piece of art. But, let's see, why can't I see the post on Instagram? Okay. It's not giving me, there we go, alright. But look, wow, that looks delicious, but that's soap. I can't imagine, you know, like, using that as a bathing instrument. That is wild. Wow. It even looks moist and everything. You know, that is amazing. Pickles, huh? Well, we all know what soap this is going to be used for. That looks like real fruit. That is amazing. These are truly awesome. You can tell these are fake, though. They don't have the seeds in this pits. But, or maybe seedless. You know, those are a thing. Heart-shaped waffles, always good. Ooh. Liquor and chocolate. Hell yeah. Man, dude, these are all awesome. A baguette, really? Wow. Alright, anyway, let's move on up. More from Audi Central. 29-year-old woman poses as teenage high school student to relive glory days. Wow, that's really sad and pathetic, honestly. A 29-year-old South Korean woman who forged her birth certificate in order to pose as a 16-year-old teenager to enroll at a New Jersey high school claimed that she did it only out of nostalgia. This January of this year, Haejing Shin, a 29-year-old South Korean woman and legal resident of the U.S., made international news headlines after being caught pretending to be a 16-year-old girl at the New Brunswick High School in New Jersey. Just a few days into her high school adventure, New Brunswick staff discovered that she had faked her birth certificate in order to gain admission. The discovery was made during the vetting process, but recently revealed information suggested that Sin was also reported by a number of students whom she had started acting weird with. The young Korean woman claimed she had never intended to hurt anyone and that she merely wanted to relive the experience that made her feel the safest growing up. Now that's, you know, as I said, you know, if you can't get yourself out of, you know, your nostalgia, you're not living for your future. You're reliving what you've already gone through, you know, and that's really not good. So, anyway, more from Audi Central. German brewery claims its beer in powder form could change industry forever. I don't know. I don't like the sound of that. Neuseeler Klosterbrau, a brewery in eastern Germany, claims to have devised a way to create a powdered beer that, when mixed with water, tasted almost exactly like the original liquid beverage. Alright, well, let's see how this goes. Maybe beer in space, you know, although we don't need a drunk captain piloting a spaceship. That sounds bad. The global beer industry is massive, but it's also one of the least efficient in the world. Transporting large quantities of beer bottled in heavy glass bottles all over the world is expensive, but what if you didn't have to? What if some of the world's most famous breweries could just ship their products overseas in powdered form, and the company on the receiving end could just add water to it? German brewery Neuseeler Klosterbrau claims to have come up with a process to create any type of beer in powdered form, alcohol and carbonation included. All anyone has to do is add water and they are left with a regular beer. Alright, well, I don't know how you're going to powder form carbonation, you know, but, I mean, you know, the future sounds crazy. Science and so, but yeah, like, as I have yet to say so far, like, for further reading on every article we've gone through, this one and the further ones we will get to, please refer to the underbar in the description below. Links to every article is down there. But anyway, more from UPI. Actually, no, moving on up to UPI. Colorado man became oldest to cross the Grand Canyon at the age of 91. Well, all right. A 91-year-old Colorado man took an approximately 24-mile trek to become the Guinness World Record holder for oldest person to cross the Grand Canyon rim-to-rim on foot. Guinness World Records said John Jepkema was 91 years and 152 days old when he and his group of friends completed their five-day backpacking hike. I don't know why I'm so out of breath. I guess I'm just yelling. I don't know into the mic. I don't know. The group started on the North Rim's North Kaibab Trail and descended 14.3 miles and 6,000 feet to the bottom of the canyon, where they headed toward the Bright Angel Trail and ascended about 9.6 miles and 4,500 feet to the South Rim. All right, well, that's cool. So at 91 years, he's still going out there and doing hikes and you know, keep up the good work, Mr. Jepkema. Like, that is, you know, that is admirable right there. Tell you what. But anyway, going back into more alcoholic stuff again, more from UPI. New Tennessee distillery boasts world's longest bar. A new distillery in Tennessee broke a Guinness World Record when this bar was measured at 518 feet long. The Humble Baron Whiskey Distillery in Shelbyville said a Guinness World Records agitator visited the establishment and confirmed the 518-foot bar broke the record of 405 feet and 10 inches, which was set by Beer Barrel Saloon in Ohio's South Bass Island. Or South Bass Island, I don't know. But hey, cool. World's longest bar. That's pretty interesting. And from the world's longest bar to the largest cake ball, more from UPI, Nebraska coffee chain breaks world's largest cake ball. A Nebraska-based coffee chain broke a Guinness World Record by assembling an 848-pound cake ball in celebration of its 25th anniversary. Scooter's Coffee, based in Omaha, assembled the cake ball in its annual Grow Conference at the CHI Health Center in Omaha. Has to be in Nebraska. So here's an article about it. That's a big cake ball right there. Covered in fake sprinkles, or for whatever reason, some people call them jimmies. But I guess they're also called they're called something else other than sprinkles as well. But hey, you know, a huge cake ball, awesome. So let's move on up here. This is kind of sad. More from UPI: overturned truck spills 10,000 wine bottles on the California highway. The California Highway Patrol said cleanup crews were summoned to a stretch of highway when a truck overturned and spilled its load of about 10,000 empty wine bottles into the roadway. Okay, so they're empty. Are they going to a bottling plant? Like, that can't be a recycling thing. They're all the same shade and everything, but... the CHP's Santa Rosa office said that the truck overturned on Highway 101 near Healdsburg, and the trailer ripped open, spilling its load of about 10,000 empty wine bottles into the roadway. All right. Okay. Let's move on up from Associated Press News. And I saw a meme about this not too long ago. Two escape jail and go to IHOP, where patrons report them. Well, you know, what's the number one thing everybody wants to do after they go to prison? They need some pancakes. Two inmates in a Virginia jail used primitively made tools to create a hole in the wall of their cell and escape, only to be found hours later at an IHOP restaurant nearby, a sheriff said. Authorities discovered the two men, ages 37 and 43, missing from their cell in the Newport News jail annex during a routine headcount on Monday evening, according to a statement from the Newport News' sheriff's office. Man, this is crazy. A preliminary investigation found the men exploited a weakness in the jail's construction design, used tools made from a toothbrush and a metal object to access rebars between the walls, and then used the rebar to further their escape, the statement said. After escaping their cell, they scaled the containment wall around the jail. Authorities had asked for the public's help to find the men, and they were taken into custody again early Tuesday at an IHOP in Hampton, where other patrons called the police. So I guess they just showed up in their prison outfits. That's crazy. And last but not least, more from AP News. This one's interesting. What made Beethoven sick? DNA from his hair offer clues. So, yeah, like, we've figured out a lot of things with King Tut. Checking the DNA from his mummy. Figured out what diseases he had. What he was afflicted with based off of, the compounds and chemicals and such in his skin. And, you know, blood vessels and all that stuff. Science is amazing today. Nearly 200 years after Ludwig von Beethoven's death, researchers pulled DNA from strands of his hair, searching for clues about the health problems and hearing loss that plagued him. They weren't able to crack the case of the German composer's deafness or severe stomach ailments, but they did find a genetic risk for liver disease, plus a liver-damaging hepatitis B infection in the last months of his life. So he could have been taken by hepatitis. So that's interesting. These factors, along with the chronic drinking, were probably enough to cause his liver failure. This is widely believed to have killed him, according to a study published Wednesday in the journal Current Biology. Huh. Well, all right. So, we can use DNA to figure out, you know, how people died in antiquity. That's pretty cool. But anyway, that shall conclude the show. Once again, you can check the underbar in the description for any links you may be interested in, including but unlimited to all things Omni Coalition. For your dose of different, odd, and otherwise, strange news, we stream every Tuesday and Friday at 2 p.m. Pacific Time, which is 3 Mountain, 4 Central, and 5 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. For all of you and all of us, I am Ayo Xander, and you are you. And until you catch us on Tuesday, or if you like history, we have a history show every day at 10 in the morning Pacific Time. Anyway, until then, don't forget to look right and left at every intersection, rate 5 thumbs, and subscribe. Toodles!